Penguin Random House Audio presents Assassin's Fate, Book 3 of the Fitz and the Fool Trilogy by Robin Hobb. Read for you by Elliot Hill. To Fitz and the Fool, my best friends for over 20 years. Prologue. There are children holding hands in a circle. In the middle, a single child stands. The child wears a blindfold, but there are painted eyes on the blindfold. The eyes are black and staring, edged with red. The child in the middle turns in a circle, hands outstretched. All the other children dance in a wider circle around her. They sing a song. As long as the circle holds, the futures can be foretold. You must be hard of heart to tear the circle apart. It looks like a merry game. Each child in the outer circle shouts a sentence or a phrase. I cannot hear what they are saying, but the blinded child can. She begins to shout back at them, her words torn by a slowly rising wind. Burn it all! The dragons fall! The sea will rise! The jewel-strewn skies! One comes as two! The four shall rue! Two come as one. Your reign is done. Forfeit all lives. No one survives. At that last shout, a gale bursts from the child in the middle. Bits of her fly in all directions, and the wind picks up the screaming children and scatters them far and wide. All becomes black, save for one circle of white. In the center of the circle is the blindfold, with its black eyes staring. Staring. Dream Journal of B. Farcia. Chapter 1. Bee Stings. The map room at Aslevial displayed a territory that included much of the Six Duchies, part of the Mountain Kingdom, a large section of Chalced, and lands along both sides of the Rain Wild River. I suspect that it defines for us the boundaries of the ancient Elderling's territory at the time the maps were created. I have been unable to inspect the map room of the abandoned Elderling city, now known as Kelsingra, personally, but I believe it would be very similar. On the Aslevial map were marked points that correspond to standing stones within the Six Duchies. I think it fair to assume that the identical markings in locations in the mountains, rain wilds, and even Chalced indicate standing stones that are skill portals. The conditions of those foreign portals are largely unknown, and some skill users caution against attempting to employ them until we have physically journeyed there and witnessed that they are in excellent condition. For the skill portal stones within the Six Duchies and the Mountain Kingdom, it seems prudent not only to send skilled couriers to visit every site, but also to require every duke to see that any such standing stones are maintained upright. The couriers who visit each stone should document the content and condition of the runes on each face of the stone as well. In a few instances, we have found standing stones that do not correspond to a marking on the Aslevial map. We do not know if they were raised after the map was created, or if they are stones that no longer function. We must continue to regard them with caution, as we do all use of Elderling magic. We cannot consider ourselves to be masters of it until we can duplicate their artifacts. Skill Portals, Shade Fullstar. I ran. I hiked up the heavy white fur coat I wore and ran. I was already too warm, and it dragged and snagged on every twig or trunk I passed. Behind me, Dwalia was shouting for someone to catch her! Catch her! I could hear the Chalcedian making mooing noises. He galloped wildly, once passing so close to me that I had to dodge him. My thoughts raced faster than my feet. I remembered being dragged by my captors into a skill pillar. I even recalled how I had bitten the Chalcedian, hoping to make him release Shun. And he had. But he'd held on to me and followed us into the darkness of the skill pillar. No Shun had I seen, nor that servant who had been last in our chain of folk. Perhaps both she and Shun had been left behind. I hoped Shun would escape her, or perhaps had escaped her. I remembered the cold of a buck winter clutching at us when we fled. But now we were somewhere else, and instead of deep cold, I felt only chill. The snow had retreated into narrow fingers of dirty white in the deeper shade of the trees. The forest smelled of early spring, but no branches had yet leafed out. How did one leap from winter in one place to spring in another? Something was very wrong, but I had no time to consider it. I had a more pressing concern. How did one hide in a leafless forest? I knew I could not outrun them. I had to hide. I hated the coat fiercely. I could not pause to wriggle out the bottom of it, for my hands felt as clumsy as fish flippers, but I could not possibly hide from my pursuers in a huge white fur coat. So I fled, knowing I could not escape, but too frightened to let them reclaim me. Choose a place to take a stand. Not where they can corner you, but not where they can surround you either. Find a weapon, a stick, a rock, anything. If you cannot escape, make them pay as dearly as you can for capturing you. Fight them all the way. Yes, Wolf Father. I spoke his name in my mind to give me courage. I reminded myself that I was the child of a wolf. Even if my teeth and claws were pathetic things, I would fight. But I was already so tired. How could I fight? I could not understand what the passage through the stone had done to me. Why was I so weak and so tired? I wanted to fall where I was and be still. I longed to let sleep claim me, but I dared not. I could hear them calling to one another, shouting and pointing at me. Time to stop running, time to make my stand. I chose my spot, a cluster of three trees, their trunks so close together that I could dodge between them, but none of my pursuers could easily follow me. I could hear at least three people crashing through the bushes behind me. How many might there be? I tried to calm myself enough to think. Dwalia, their leader, the woman who had smiled so warmly as she stole me from my home. She had dragged me through the skill pillar. And Vindalaya, the boy man who could make people forget what they had experienced. He had come through the stone. Kerf was the Chalcedian sellsword, but his mind was so scrambled from our skill journey that either he was no danger to anyone, or he might kill any of us. Who else? Alaria, who would unquestioningly do whatever Dwalia told her, as would Repin, who had so harshly crushed my hand as we came through the pillar. It was a much smaller force than she had started with, but they still outnumbered me 5-1. I crouched behind one of the trees, pulled my arms from the sleeves of the heavy fur robe, and at last wriggled and lifted until I could slide out of it. I picked it up and threw it as far as I could, which was not far. Should I run on? I knew I could not. My stomach was doubling and twisting uneasily, and I had a stitch in my side. This was as far as I could go. A weapon. There was nothing. Only a fallen branch. The thick end was no bigger around than my wrist, and it diverged into three limbs at the other end. A poor weapon. More rake than staff. I took it up. Then I pressed my back to one of the trees, hoping against hope that my pursuers would see the coat and pass me by, so I could double back and find a better hiding spot. They were coming. Dwalia shouted in gasps.
I know you are frightened, but don't run. You will starve and die without us. A bear will eat you. You need us to survive. Come back, bee. No one will be angry at you.
Then I heard the lie as she turned her fury on her followers.
Oh, where is she? Elleria, you fool, get up. None of us feels well, but without her, we cannot go home.
then, letting her anger win.
Bee, stop being foolish. Come here, right now. Vindalaya, hurry. If I can run, so can you. Find her. Fog her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.